Hello and welcome to the Washington Week Webcast Extra, where we pick up where we left off in the main broadcast. I'm joined around the table tonight by Molly Ball of The Atlantic, Gene Cummings of Bloomberg News, John Harwood of CNBC and The New York Times, and Doyle McManus of The Los Angeles Times. Certainly the most intriguing story of the week was the tale of the missing American who turned out to be a CIA agent. So what do we know about Robert Levinson, Doyle?
What we know is a very tangled story and an interesting human story and one of the great bureaucratic catastrophes, you'd have to say, of recent CIA history. Robert Levinson was a retired FBI agent who was looking for work, and he was looking for interesting things to do. This was back in 2006, 2007. He was 59 years old, and he had a friend, a pal he had met at a conference once, who was an analyst at the CIA. And Levinson had spent a lot of time on international issues for the FBI. He had done drug cases, he had done smuggling, he had done currency stuff. He thought of himself as a terrific collector of intelligence, and he started feeding this stuff to his friend at the CIA, who put him on an $85,000 a year contract. But the odd thing here is the CIA has really kind of two branches. Operations are done by the operations, what used to be called the operations directorate. They changed the name, but I'm too old, so I use the old name. And then all the information comes in, and it's analyzed and written into reports by the analysts. And the analysts aren't supposed to send agents out. The operations people send agents out, actually officers out, and the operations people know how to protect them, and they know how to do disguises, and they know how to do fake passports, and all of that cool stuff that you see in the movies. But here was this set of analysts who thought, hey, this is cool. We've got this consultant, but he's kind of our own covert operative, and we can send him out to find things. And Mr. Levinson liked the idea, too, because he was doing romantic, exciting stuff and making money. Anyway, cut to the chase. He wanted to develop an agent, that is to say, a foreign source of information inside Iran, for his folks at the CIA.
This is where it takes to turn into a script from Homeland.
Exactly. He's in the Persian Gulf. He gets on a little day flight to Kish Island, which is an island in the Persian Gulf off Iran, but Iran sort of uses it as an offshore meeting place. It's got hotels on it. It's got resorts on it. It's a little bit like Hong Kong instead of China. Mr. Levinson goes up there for a meeting with this Iranian he wants to see, and he disappears. And that was in March of 2007.
And to cut to the chase, they say all along, the U.S., that he has nothing to do with them, that he is not a CIA agent, that he's a businessman who's been taken hostage, they think.
Because as far as the operations director of the CIA knows, he's not one of theirs.
But he's a contractor.
He was a contractor for this set of analysts who went quiet on the whole thing because they knew they had messed up big time. And they actually didn't confess to it until several years later, after some of Mr. Levinson's friends went through his emails, took them to Senator Nelson of Florida, where he lives. Nelson went to the agency. The agency said, oops, we have a problem here.
Paid his family $2.5 million to just accept that maybe they should have let them know that their loved one was gone.
And at that late date, began doing what you do internationally to try and get someone back. But at that point, the Iranian government, truthfully or not, says,
we could talk about this for the whole webcast.
We don't know where he is. We don't know anything.
It's a great story.
It's a great story.
Story, but there may be a tragedy in it. The man may be dead, and we don't know it.
Yeah. And still nobody responsible for why he went, where he went, what became of him. It's an amazing story. And how it happened to come out, to come surface now, which is a media story, which is separate. We'll hear more about that. I want to go back to domestic conversation and start with you, Gene, because what we see happening, and Molly, everybody weigh in on this, but one of the interesting things we talked about in the main broadcast was the hit that the president has taken in his personal standing. And in part, it's because the health care plan, not just the botched rollout, but the whole plan has turned out to be a slippery slope. It's been hard to grab purchase on it to get any positive that you could come away and say, looky what I've done for you, even when you have testimonials. How slippery a slope is health care for the president?
Well, January is likely to be another difficult month because there are going to be people who think they've signed up, and then they may go to a doctor and discover that their paperwork didn't quite work.
Right.
I think also you're going to have people who are sick, who finally have got health care. And so capacity could become an issue. Can they get the doctor's appointment that they want with the doctor that they want, or even with any doctor? I mean, just anecdotally, I was talking recently with a friend who was setting up a routine mammogram and had to wait 3 weeks to get an appointment, and she expressed surprise. And the clerk said, "Are you joking? Wait until next year." When indeed, you know, everyone will have this as coverage. So there are going to be issues like that that are practical issues that the first year shakeout is going to deliver some bad headlines. That said, I think the Republicans are collecting all these really terrible stories. My guess is the Democrats are going to be able to collect just as many stories about families who finally get coverage, people with pre-existing conditions who finally get coverage, and people who, you know, have costs that do go down. There'll be the vignette story is going to be
a vignette war. So, but that is that going to play out in the primaries, especially that we're going to see next year? Is it a strong enough issue to be used, especially in the some of the Republican primaries that were they're being teed up now?
I don't think this is a primary issue. No. This is a partisan issue, and as Jean said, both parties think they have a winning issue here. The Republicans think that this is their winning hand. They want to get the shutdown stuff out of the way and all the fiscal stuff out of the way to avoid distracting the American people from what they believe to be the train wreck that is Obamacare. Partly this is ideological. They believe that this can't work, that government can't do something this big well, and so they are convinced that this can't possibly work. But partly, you know, the evidence is there that a lot of people who warned about the difficulties of implementing something like this were right, at least in the initial going. So, you know, the Democrats also believe that there will be so many people grateful to be getting health care. The Medicaid expansion is a sort of underplayed aspect of all this, but many more people are getting health care through the expansion of Medicaid than through these federal exchanges. And that is a popular part of the program that a lot of Republican governors have resisted, and they will be on the ballot too. So, you know, in a lot of ways, Democrats are reaping what they sowed by passing this on a party line vote. Republicans didn't give them a choice in that, but that has meant that every aspect of this is completely partisan and charged.
And does that mean, John, and you wrote about this week, that we can't expect any big things to happen anymore in 2014? Everyone has bit off as much as they can chew, and they're just trying to survive.
Definitely. Democrats don't have the capacity. The Obama administration doesn't have the capacity to push through big pieces of legislation, although we still have immigration hanging out there. And don't forget, a key element is Republicans have a self-interest in doing something about that problem. I don't think that's dead. But apart from that, I think for the administration, they're relieved at the budget deal, assuming it passes the Senate, and they're going to try to focus on implementing health care, using the executive authority the president has to move on climate change and carbon. John Podesta came back this week. He's going to work on that. But there's not going to be a lot of movement. There's going to be a lot of political trench warfare between a narrow set of outcomes because of the number of seats at risk. And I think nobody should expect a dramatic legislative year in 2014.
By the way, you mentioned John Podesta coming back. Are we seeing a slow motion shakeup going on at the White House? The legislative affairs director is leaving. Somebody else is taking his place. John Podesta, the former chief of staff, is coming
Bill
back.
Shaliro, very veteran back. Aide, very effective, is coming
Phil
back.
Phil Rouse, one of the president's closest advisors, as they say, we'll see if it actually happens, leaving. Does that make things happen differently in the White House, or is that just rearranging?
Well, I do think the president, who's faced a lot of criticism for being too insular and having a set of aides who have been with him for a long time, now has a new voice in John Podesta with a lot of stature in the Democratic Party.
He has Isn't been... he an old voice?
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, but he's new to this team.
But he
yeah.
knows also how to do the end of a presidency.
Oh.
And, you know, I mean, the first year...
Bill Clinton's
first,
relief pitcher.
Yeah, the Closer. First tenure, you know, his first term is all about trying to do past things, and now he's in his last 2 years. Mm-hmm. And that's a very different place to be, requiring perhaps a very different team. Just one note on immigration. I agree with John. I don't think it's gone. I think it's gone for 2014.
Yeah.
And I think that Boehner has calculated 2015 before the presidential is a window in which they could try to do something to improve their standing before a national election with Hispanic voters. But for the midterms, he doesn't need to do that.
Well, and hope springs eternal among the sort of immigration activists. Yeah. But the problem is they're not going to wait that long. And they are already waging war on Republicans for dragging their heels as long as they have. And that's poison the well in some regard, I think.
It gives us a lot to talk about. Yeah. And we will. Thank you, everybody. Stay online and read what else our panelists are reporting and also what they're reading on our Washington Week winter reading list. And we'll see you next week on the Washington Week Webcast Extra.